Hi, this is Marlene with Miami Ghost Chronicles, and I want to welcome you to another episode of Stories of the Supernatural. Wherever you find us, whether it's a video or podcast on your favorite platform, please like and subscribe to us so that you can get notification of when a new show is released. You can also find us on major social media platforms. If you go to MiamiGhostChronicles.com, you can find links to the videos or MP3 files, which you can download and enjoy without commercial interruptions. If you're into classic horror, ghost, and adventure stories, I narrate Nightshade Diary, and you can find links at nightshadediary.com. If scary stories are your bag, and listening to encounters with cryptids, ghosts, dogmen, and other weird creatures sends a shiver up your spine, then go to supernaturalstorytime.com for links to our weekly podcasts. Noteworthy news about the paranormal world, true crime, conspiracy stories, and anything that is just plain weird can be found at eerie.news or visit the Stranger Than Fiction Stories tab at MiamiGhostChronicles.com. Please subscribe to my newsletter on Substack. Just go to mppellicer.com for a link. I want to thank you for being part of my audience, and I think you are all wonderful.
So, hi. How's everybody doing? Good? I'm hoping that yes, that's a yes, right? Even though the show's a little bit staggered. I'm recording this the day after Thanksgiving. So happy Thanksgiving, everybody. Also, I know some people are going to say, yes, I did, you know, for the people that followed me on the hypnosis video that I said my resolution was for 1 year, no haircut. I did it. So finally I gave in and I cut in a little bit, but I did the 1 year. And also I want to mention that I am going to do a live stream for New Year's resolutions. And a lot of people had asked me that instead of doing it so close to the New Year's, that I should do it earlier for somebody wanting to prepare what they should do for New Year's resolutions so that they don't crash and burn, like we talked about in last year's video about things that can happen, how people sometimes set themselves up for failure because, you know, that quote unquote, it's the perfect time of year to do the New Year's resolution. And that's a whole nother show. And again, don't forget to catch me on Substack because again, that's where I send out not only articles, I have links to older shows, 5 or 6 years old, that are really great. And it's every once in a while, I'll look at them. And it's really funny because some of these videos, I call them BC as in or before COVID. And it's like, you can tell the content and some of my comments were totally different. Like, before and after. So yeah, it's one of those things. Again, go to substack.com and you'll find me there, MP Pellicer. Like I said, I send out information on giveaways, new books, also, you know, links to all the MP3s or older shows. I do all of that through Substack. The newsletter is the best way to be on top of what's going on, or if not, go to MiamiGhostChronicles.com. Now, let's get on to the good part. And the good part has to do with who the guest is today. And this is the first time that this gentleman's been here on Stories of the Supernatural. His name is Daniel Duke. And let me tell you a little bit about him. He is the great-great-grandchild of Jesse James. He grew up surrounded by stories of lost outlaw treasures. For more than 2 decades, he's been researching the mysteries involving his connection with family, Freemasonry, the Knights Templar, and the secrets of the Wild Wild West. I can't wait to talk to him about this. Help me welcome him. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Hey, how are you?
Great. Fantastic. Dan, let me ask you, obviously this is a family thing. Was this something that you knew about early in life as far as what your background and your family was, or did you come into it later on in life? How did you get this information?
Yeah, well, my lawyer, Betty Dorsett Duke, she had in 2015, when she grew up, the story went down through the family, oral tradition. Every time we were at a family get together, holiday, things like that, all the old timers talk about how Jesse didn't die as history said. They said that, you know, he faked his death, came to Texas, and died at the age of 1903. And we didn't, you know, my late mother had no reason to doubt it, none of us doubted it. But when my sister and I went to college, mom had enough time to start researching. So she started doing genealogy, and she got all the old family photos, there, things like that. And she took the photos. Like, we knew that the photos that we had looked just like Jesse and his family's photos, but
right.
we also knew that people wouldn't accept our word for it. So we went to the experts.
Right. Okay.
And ended up going to the Texas Department of Public Safety, Austin Police Department, and out of New Jersey called Visionics, who were facial recognition. They sold their software to military, airports, stuff like that. And all three groups, our photos matched Jesse and his family. So it was
started.
Yeah. And it just went from there.
That's incredible. But you're right. I understand what you were saying. You guys said, you know, one thing is what's talked about within the family, but if we go out there, we need to show concrete proof that it's just not stories that, you know, that families have, but there's no basis of truth in them.
Exactly. And along with, you know, like all the, we have Jesse's diary. It was down through the family. It was just one of them. There's a couple more out there, but certain family members are holding on to them, not anybody for some reason. But we've got 1871 to 1876, and it lists in his diary, he wrote his signature, J. James. He also wrote his initials, J.W.J. And there's one of known gang members that are in his diary.
So let me ask you, that story that everybody hears, how Jesse James was assassinated and everything, what do you think that was? Was that done on purpose by him to fake his death, or did he survive a shooting? How did that happen?
The first, he tried to fake it twice. First time in 1979, and he went out. They all were tired of it. You know, you're playing a numbers game, living that kind of life. And he knew, you know, it's you're living on borrowed time. So he wanted out. He wanted a peace life. He tried to fake his death. One of his gang members, George Shepherd, helped him, said that he rode into town and claimed he shot Jesse in the back of the head. And nobody would believe it. So the posse went out looking for the body. They couldn't find a body. So that joke, you know, it didn't work. And a couple of years later, in 1882, Jesse's cousin Wood Height, who looked a lot like Jesse, he was his first. He was, involved in a weird love triangle with Bob and Charlie Ford's sister Martha, and Martha was sleeping not only with Wood, but she was also sleeping with her man Jim. Well, Wood Height and Jim Gibson showed up at the farmhouse the same day. They got in a shootout. Wood Height shot Jim Gibson and killed him. And Bob and Charlie, one of the two, Bob or Charlie, one of those two shot Wood Height, and it hit him in the back of the head. And they used that body and passed it off as Jesse. And a lot of people, these days that would be very hard to do. But back then there were no IDs, no numbers.
No.
We didn't have cameras and photographs everywhere. There were a couple of photographs of him, but his family had that. And the Pinkerton Detective Agency, who had been chasing Jesse for over a decade, they didn't know what he was like. So the law enforcement and all these other specialists and agents couldn't figure out what Jesse looked like. They didn't know if he was short and overweight or tall and lean or what. So it was easy to pass pass Wood Height off as Jesse. The only people who could verify what he looked like were his family and gang members, and they all sided with Jesse.
Right, because and if you look at some of those wanted posters from back then, you look at them and so sometimes they do the sketch artist. It says that could be any. I mean, it narrows it down, but that could be a lot of people.
A lot of people.
You know, it's like if I came across this person, I really wouldn't be sure it's him. You know, especially back in those years, sometimes men wore the big mustaches and the beards and stuff like that, or the mutton chops. All they had to do was either grow it or shave it off. And this is a different person altogether.
Exactly. And sometimes they would even use mustache wax and comb through their hair to change the color of their hair.
Oh, so I didn't know. So yeah, there was ways, of course, to, and I imagine you're absolutely right. Do you think that it was just that, what was it? Because at that point, he already had a reward out for him. Is that it?
Yeah, there was a large reward. They were robbing so many banks and stages and trains mm-hmm. in Missouri alone. The railroads were trying to go around Missouri instead of go through it. So it was hurting the state's economy. So, sure.
Yeah, no, I bet.
Yeah. And he had a big reward. Bob and Charlie Ford, I don't know if they thought they were helping. I'd met one of Bob Ford's descendants, and he claimed that their family said that Bob had always helped Jesse. But Bob ended up getting killed over it years later. And Charlie Ford committed suicide.
Interesting. Yep. So and let me ask you, was that reward for him dead or alive kind of deal? Or was it just if they brought him in alive?
Dead or alive.
Ah, yeah, that's the bad part. That's the bad part. And, you know, because back then people, there was such a thing as bounty hunters, right? Not like the bounty, not like skip tracers. These were actual people. That's all they did. That's how they made their living.
Yeah.
It was bounty hunting. Yeah.
That's right. And the thing about what made it so hard for a bounty hunter to try to catch anybody involved with Jesse and his gang, they were all kind of like special forces in their day. During the Civil War, they were some of the most feared fighters in the Civil War in that part of the country.
Right. And I believe they would go into really inhospitable parts of the country, you know, places that, you know, if you didn't know what you were doing, that's it. You're lucky if you find a place, and chances are a million things could happen to you if you didn't know what you were doing, in other words.
That's true. And another thing about the James gang that I think helped them go along without ever getting caught is they would go into saloons. And the only time they entered a town is if they absolutely had to, and they would go in and keep quiet and lay low. So they didn't go to where, you know, they didn't look for trouble. They always tried to go in town. So.
Right. Because sometimes it's really funny, because some of these outlaws, sometimes they met death, not because exactly what you were saying, wrong place, wrong time, had a big mouth, got into a fight with the wrong person. You know, there was even such a thing back then as revenge killings back then. That was a big deal. Where years later, families would remember, you know, you killed cousin so-and-so or uncle so-and-so and they'd gun for you.
Kind of like the Hatfield Democrats.
Yeah, you know, everybody thinks that the bygones be bygones. Nuh-uh. Back then, if somebody knew, hey, you know, so-and-so shot your brother in that bar fight, whatever.
That's right.
5 years later, that you could end up dead because somebody from that family saw you or found you or whatever. And even the score. Yeah, people didn't forget about
and
like that.
I was just talking about that yesterday with somebody. One of my friends, I mentioned it, Wild Bill Hickok. He was, you know, he was a gunfighter, and he killed a man in a fair fight. Years later, that man's son grew up and got a gun and shot Wild Bill Hickok in the back. Just because he was getting revenge.
Right. And people don't understand, like, Wild Bill Hickok, one day you were an outlaw, you shot somebody, and then the next day they'd hire you as a sheriff. Because some of these towns, they were so wild, that they just couldn't hire an ordinary sheriff. They
That's
needed
right.
somebody that knew how to handle all these wild guys, the cowboys. You know, you couldn't be just anybody. It's because some of them, it was really hard work. Because these guys were like, and Wild Bill Hickok, you know, one day you're wanted, and the next day the mayor of the little town and the Chamber of Commerce hire you because the town is growing and they can't have people running around shooting each other or shooting other people. And people don't realize how crazy it was back then as far as you even hear it with these stories of Wyatt Earp and things like that, that you go one moment he's doing the same thing, law enforcement, and then the other side of that he's wanted for something. That was more common than people think.
A lot of the Texas Rangers were that way too. There's a lot of stories of that with Texas Rangers. One day they're rustling cattle, the next day they're catching cattle rustlers. So it was just whoever paid them the best.
I think they were disbanded for a few years, like around 1850, if I remember correctly. They were disbanded and then they brought them together. And I remember that they would have a lot of problems, you know, with the Chisholm Trail out of Texas, you know, bringing that cattle up to those stockades where the trains, like you were talking about, the trains are coming across the country. Yeah. And a lot of wild stuff happened on that Chisholm Trail. And that's why they would have those towns that would spring up all of a sudden, because they were on a depot where the, you know, they would bring in the cattle. But it was wild times back then. Yes,
it was very wild.
Very wild. And let me ask you, how did Jesse get into holding up? Was it something that happened? Was it because of the war, after the war? How did he get involved with that?
When we first got into it, you know, during the Civil War, he started when he was 14. And it was bad. Union backed guerrillas went to his farm. They strapped him to a plow and beat him. And then they strapped his mother to a tree and they hung his stepfather until they didn't kill him, but he had brain damage, permanent brain damage from then on. So he wanted revenge. He went and found Quantrell's guerrillas. They let him fight with them. The regular Confederacy wouldn't let him fight. And he just wanted revenge. He didn't really care about politics. It was just revenge. So all through the Civil War, he was very good at killing. Like the men who trained him were very good at killing. Sure. And he learned from some of the best. After the Civil War, there's a lot involved with that. Like during the Civil War, I'm sure you've heard of Albert Pike, the famous 33rd degree Mason.
Absolutely.
He was a brigadier. Yeah, he was a brigadier general. And Jesse's group and Albert Pike's group used to have the same, they would camp out in the same spot a few times during the Civil War. And I always wondered if that's where he, I'm not sure, but often that's where he came into contact with Freemasonry. After the Civil War, normal Confederate soldiers were granted amnesty, but none of the guerrillas were. So Jesse and his group, if you were a guerrilla, you were shot on sight. He tried to turn himself in at the end of the war, and they shot him, and he got it through his right lung. And that was the second time he'd been shot through his lung, but he survived. And I guess the best way I can see that, there's nothing written down on that, but it appears that he couldn't turn himself in. So he had two choices, either stay an outlaw or leave the country. He chose to stay.
Right. Yeah, exactly. A lot of people don't realize what the country was like right after the Civil War, how crazy it was, what you were describing. People don't realize what it was, especially when it go out further west. You know, like when I mean west, I don't mean far west. All you had to do was, like you said, go further west to Ohio, Missouri, you know, where the frontier then was. And it was like no man's land as far as law and order.
It was right. You didn't know who was going to kill you. I mean, you could die easily any day at any time. You could meet somebody on the road and they could shoot you. So
you hear crazy. That stuff. Right. It was, and like you said, there was no forensics back then. If somebody shot you out in the middle of nowhere, who was going to say who did it, how they did it? You know, that's it. You'd be gone. And maybe if you're lucky, they found your body and gave you a decent burial. So,
very true.
And let me ask you now, you said something about his having contact with Albert Pike. Did he become a Mason or a Freemason or anything afterwards or anything like that?
On record, he was a Mason under his alias James Lafayette Courtney. That was the alias he took when to Texas. In fact, his band still keeps the Courtney name. But anyway, everybody in the lodge, and we were told by a few Masons who went to the same lodge he did, of course, after he died, all those families in that small area where he lived in Texas, they all know that he was Jesse, and all the Masons that he was at lodge with knew that he was Jesse. Okay. They knew his real identity. And it just on after he passed away, people still talk about it around that town. And I have some elderly Masons who were still, they were kids when Jesse was old, like Droming, for example. He was a 32nd degree Scottish Rite, and he helped Jesse when he was 10 to 12 years old. Jesse hired him, swore him to an oath, and to help him carry 7 bars of gold. That one treasure catch alone is more than the James Gang stole in their entire history of rock. So I always wondered, how did he get 700 bars of gold? And that was just one treasure that he buried.
So, right. Because that's the thing about the James Gang. They were known that they would stash their proceeds, whatever they were, in different places because you couldn't go running around the country with money or gold or whatever. You couldn't. You just couldn't do it. So basically, they were known for stashing their gold or whatever it was. And that's part of the lore, right? That they say a lot of it hasn't been recovered.
Yeah. Some have recovered. Some has been recently. Former Attorney General of the state of Texas, Wagner Carr, for example. He would call my mother, and he was interested in Jesse and the gold. But he was later. I found out Wagner Carr was also a Freemason. And I don't know if that's why he was contacting my mom, or maybe all three. But his driver picked my mother and I up, and he showed me three areas where large catches of gold were recovered. His driver had personally been to two of those sites, and she saw him recover. The Texas Rangers oversaw the recovery. And I asked what they did with it, and I never got an answer. But it was interesting. She had one of the sites, for example, was so large it took several 18-wheelers several trips to unload all the gold. It had gold dating back to like a Spanish gold and a lot of other gold ingots and bars.
Right. Okay. You know, you always hear about sometimes during the Civil War that certain money shipments would go astray.
Yeah.
And, you know, you always wonder, like, where, you know, some of those things went. Because there was a lot of money. Yeah. You need it. You know, people don't realize back then, it's not like now that you do a wire transfer for thousands or millions of dollars. Yeah. Back then, to pay for soldiers and supplies and things like that, you had to actually transport the money from point A to point
they needed
B.
Gold and silver. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
And everybody, you know, yeah, and you're right. That's about one. Up until, I guess, about a century ago. It was gold and silver, a little more than centuries. But.
And I don't know, and I'm gonna segue real quick into this. I don't know if you're familiar with, this is a very recent thing called Fenn's Treasure, about that gentleman that was a collector. He lived out in Arizona. Uh-huh. And he put together all these pieces of basically collectibles and golds. He said estimated to be at $2 million, and he hit them.
Wow.
And it was, people were going crazy. And I believe it was discovered in 2020, but in the interim, I think like 5 people ended up dead because they were going to places, you know, trying to find this treasure. You know how crazy people go crazy, because he would have these clues that they would pat out. And they even had forums and, you know, chat rooms, people trying to figure out, you know, all these clues, trying to figure out if that's what they meant, you know. And that's incredible. And I think, as a matter of fact, it's going up for auction now. The guy that found it 2 years ago, he's putting it up for auction. But my point being that in comparison, people are going crazy. And, you know, so I can imagine. And as a matter of fact, God, what was it in Missouri? I'm trying to remember this story about, there was basically some where supposedly part of the Jesse James gang had, I want to say, buried, and it was coins, if I remember correctly, it was coins, and somebody had bought up the land or something, and they were supposed to be hidden in there. And the gentleman that was there, he I believe the one that he met was Jesse James' brother. God, Marlene, I can't remember that story now. But basically, even then, even years afterwards, this, we're talking over the, like, 1905, people were still going out there trying to locate where this money was at, or where the stash was at, whatever it was.
That's true.
So what did he do? Did he, after this thing where he, they thought, everybody thought, okay, he's dead. What did he do? Where did he go?
He went to Texas. He was in Texas when Woodhite was shot. And he went up to the, he traveled up, he traveled north, he went to his parents because, well, his mom already knew it wasn't him, but he went to, and he even attended the funeral. And we have a photo showing him at his own funeral, standing next to his mother, and nobody knew who it was. It's really, it's wild, but nobody knew who he was, so, yeah.
People see what they expect to see, you know, exactly, that kind of deal.
Exactly. And it was his first cousin. They fought together in the war, and they were close, so I'm sure that's probably another reason why that way to travel. And I thought, that almost seems crazy of him to do that, but nobody knew what he looked like other than his family and gang members, so he was pretty safe.
Right, but I imagine what happened after that. Did he kind of have to separate himself from his family so nobody would start thinking, who is this guy that's always hanging out with a, you know, with a family now? Did he, like, go away?
He did at times, but like when Frank James got married, he got married at Jesse's house in Blevins, Texas. And that was before the faked death. But even his mom, his late mother, when she died, she was on a train heading back to Missouri from Texas, and that's, she died of old age on the way back. It was somewhere in Oklahoma where she passed away. But they would come and visit, but it was safer for her to visit him in Texas than it was for him to visit her in Missouri.
Sure, exactly. That makes a lot of sense. Right, because if you have a house out in the middle, what did he have, like a ranch or something out there where he lived?
Yeah, and he was surrounded by former Quantrell's guerrillas. They all had farms in that area. So it was a nice little, they were safe.
Right, that's where I was going with this. It's not like, you know, it's not like somebody's going to see you with, like, you know, you have to go out there and you're going to have to go on the land. And like, if he already has his neighborhood set up, even if they were ranches miles apart, that's it. Yep. Nobody's going to bother you.
That's right. It was almost, in a way, it reminds me of some of the mafia movies where you'd have a watcher, you know, when somebody entered the neighborhood, they already knew. So,
sure. Of course.
I think it's a good, it seems like a good way to do it. So just to make sure they're protected.
And you know what? In a way, it's really funny because, you know, you see a lot of the Westerns and they kind of romanticize up to a certain point that lifestyle, but they don't, the part that they leave out is that after a while, it's like, okay, if you got all this money and all this and all that, there comes a point that, what, if you don't live to enjoy it, then what happens?
Yeah. So. And see, that's where I wondered. I used to wonder, okay, they buried a lot more than they'd ever stolen. And that was just a small part of it. Outlaws, like Billy the Kid and Jesse had met in 1879. And I thought it was odd that just a few years later, both of them were allegedly killed in the same fashion by a former, a fellow gang member shot in the back kind of thing. And their stories about Billy faking his death. I haven't gone down that trail too much. I've had my hands full with Jesse, but like in his diary, for example, he detailed a robbery trip they went on into Louisiana and how they hit multiple targets in different areas because the gang would split up just like guerrilla tactics back in the war. But he stayed at a man's house by the name of Gervais Fontenot. And I thought, okay, any name I saw, I would always, you know, research them as much as I could. So I researched Gervais Fontenot and found out he was a retired U.S. Marshal. And I thought, why would Jesse and his gang rob a stagecoach and then go stay the night with U.S. Marshal? And that goes back in line, in my opinion, kind of like what we'd mentioned earlier with Texas Rangers and other lawmen. One day they're an outlaw, next day they're a lawman. But I researched Gervais Fontenot, and I found out that he was the nephew. His uncle was Jean Lafitte, the famous pirate. And that's just, it's a fact. His uncle, he was the nephew of Jean Lafitte. And then I got to reading more about Jean Lafitte, and I found out, and this is there's a lodge in Masonic Lodge in New Orleans, and they've got their history written out. And they transcribed a letter from Jean Lafitte or about Jean Lafitte during the War of 1812. And it said that Jean Lafitte had had Masonic communications with Andrew Jackson. And that told me you can't have Masonic communication unless both parties are Masons.
Are Masons, so exactly.
I thought it was interesting. There's a tie between, you know, Jean's nephew and Jesse. And it helped show a pattern. That was one of many examples, right. But it helped show a pattern of Freemasonry and pirates and outlaws throughout history. I became a Mason. I'm a 32nd degree Scottish Rite myself, but, I found out, well, I've had some people say, you know, some get offended. There's, you know, they can't believe that an outlaw would have been allowed to be a Mason. And Masons connect back to the Templar, and the Templar themselves were outlaws at one time. So, you know, it's not hard to believe, in my opinion. I mean, and the war between the Vatican and the Templar is well known. You know, they raided their coffers. They tried to get their money. They didn't get the money. All the gold disappeared over. Then you've got legends like Oak Island and a lot of other stuff. And I think the gold that the Templar took ended up here in the Americas. And I believe that Jean Lafitte and Jesse and a lot of other people were tied in with that network.
They knew something about that, unless you were in that world, for lack of a better word. And of course, let's face it, if you're talking treasure or gold, everybody's like, shut up, you know, the less you say about it, because if not, forget it, you know. You know, one of the things that I'm going to ask you your opinion on this, you know, the Templars were supposedly, they were captured and they were, you know, they were, like you said, they were outlaws as far as the Pope was concerned, and they were all, but then you think they're so powerful. They were bankers. If you look at what they were doing, and that was part of the problem among with other things. And I always thought, okay, if these people were so wired in, didn't somebody, a little bird, come and whisper in their ear and say, you guys need to get out of Dodge because they're coming for you, especially La Mole. Yeah, all these head people that ended up being, executed. I'm thinking, okay, how powerful, because back then, like in all things, espionage information was vital. So they would have their own people inserted, you know, and all these, whether it was the Vatican. And I've always wondered, how could they have been so powerful and nobody come to them and tell them, you know, we're hearing rumors about this.
Yeah, I think they knew. Talked to a couple other men about that, and historians and other 33rd degree Masons and historians and others. But most people I've talked to, and I agree too, I think they knew ahead of time. And I think Jacques de Molay, who was their Grand Master, Jacques de Molay, I believe he sacrificed himself. I mean, they were monks anyway. They kind of had that attitude. They all thought they would die in battle or for the cause. So I think a lot of them sacrificed themselves, but most of the Templar disappeared. Like they had 13 ships in a port the night before the raid. And by the next morning at dawn, when the raid was started, all the ships had disappeared. Nobody knew where they went.
See, I have never heard of that. And that's the part I'm thinking, you know what, you know, I cannot believe their information network would fail them that badly.
Yeah, exactly. I think it was made to look that way. They didn't want anybody knowing that they took off and they got all the gold. But I know the Vatican, the Pope at the time, and the King of France, King Philip the Fair is what he, that was his name. They wanted the gold, and that was one of the main objectives, was getting all their gold, and there was none to be found. All the coffers were empty. So I believe a lot of it left on the ships. I think there's a lot of treasures that were buried in Europe, but I think a large portion of it came to the Americas.
And it makes sense because it was, how can I say it? It was like out of reach, practically for all intents and purposes.
And back in those days, they had a lot of allies after they became outlawed. They were excommunicated. Scotland, all of Scotland at the time was excommunicated. So that was a logical place for them to flee to.
Why was Scotland excommunicated at that time?
It had to do with tensions with the church and with England. And they wouldn't fall in line, and the Pope excommunicated the entire country. There's a lot more to it than that. But that,
I know, I did not know that.
Yeah. So
you know why?
So
the reason why. Wow. Yeah, all of you guys. if you're Scottish, everybody. That's it. Yeah. Let me tell you something. A belief, you know, we can laugh, but back then that was a big deal. Basically, you were damning these people's souls by excommunicating them.
Yep.
This is what you were doing, in essence. Yeah. It's not like.
People wouldn't do business with them. It was like you were an outcast by the entire church, and all of Europe was at the time controlled by the Catholic Church. So if you were excommunicated, that pretty much destroyed your life and your soul on top of it. So
because you know, I always think of, you know, when Henry VIII, that, you know, that he broke away and he started the Church of England because, of course, he wanted to remarry and get an heir. I always thought that was the big break with the Vatican, with Rome. I didn't know that the Pope had done that.
Yeah.
So, and let me ask you something: is that when the Templars that they say that they came to Scotland then, as far as?
Yeah. Yep. Specifically, in the area around Roslyn Chapel near Edinburgh, Scotland. So, I tend to call it Edinburgh, but I've got my literary agent is she lives in London. She's from the UK. She always corrects me and says it's Edinburgh, not Edinburgh. So I'm like, okay, it doesn't look like it's spelled that way, but
I know it's but, like it's like the Thames River, not the you know you want to say it phonetically.
Yeah.
Is this the Scottish rite of Freemasonry is birthed out of this time period?
No, that was later. Albert Pike formed the Scottish Rite. He had written all the, and actually Morals and Dogma and a couple of other books, but he had reformed that whole part of it. They had a lot of the Scots Masons had a lot of their own oaths and rituals and stuff, but Albert Pike was credited for reforming a lot of that and organizing it.
Okay. And you know what? And the reason why I asked that is that I thought that the Freemasons, you know, when during the, you know, revolutionary colonial period into the United States, that, you know, a lot of the immigrants from Scotland and that came, they were Freemasons. And I thought that that's where that Scottish Rite of Freemasonry had come into the United States.
I used to think the same thing, but it shocked me when I found out that's right. I always thought that for some reason, before I joined the Masons, I thought George Washington was probably a 33rd degree, but there was no such degree at the time. So,
what was it? Either you were a Mason or you weren't? Is that it?
Yeah. And they had degrees, but they didn't go up to the 33rd at the time.
Okay. That's very interesting because, you know, there's always, you know, I'm sure you've heard of all the, you know, as far as the founding of the country and, you know, the impact of the Freemasons, as far as that all the founding fathers were Freemasons and things of that nature, you know, so I think a lot of times people fail to realize that also the Freemasons, it's not only because of the belief in Freemasonry, but even to conduct business and everything. It's almost like you trust another Freemason more than you would do somebody who's not a Freemason.
Yeah. And back then, they seemed a lot more, I guess, strict on their oaths and their rules. As opposed to today. I mean, you know, somebody can, I guess, cheat someone or whatever, and they, you know, it's a slap on the hand, or they may get kicked out of Freemasonry, but it's not as
right.
I guess, the consequences aren't as bad today as they used to be.
Right. Right. Well, back then it got around that, you know, you had broken a you know, like an oath or a promise or like a handshake, you know how they say those deals with a handshake, and it got around after a while, you know, especially among people that were movers and shakers. It was you're done, you know, it's gotten around that you don't keep your word.
So that's right.
You're not.
And I think that's also why it led to duels and things like that back then. If someone insulted someone, they had to protect their honor, because if they were viewed to be a coward or an a dishonest person, that could ruin everything.
Right, right. It was, I know that they could go out and duel and like shoot in the air or shoot in the ground, and basically your honor, it was, and they would agree to say, are we settled? You know, is this okay? Yep. And you're okay. But you had to show up. You had to be willing to go out there.
Yep. If you didn't show up, that was bad. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I know they outlawed dueling, but supposedly this, like you said, it was all your honor or your family honor meant a lot.
Yeah.
So you better show up and figure something out.
Yep.
That's right. Because if not, that taint by 40 years later, you'd still be known as that guy.
That's true. That's true. It could ruin your fight. It could ruin your career.
Yes, it could. It could. And that's why, you know, we have, what was it? The Aaron Burr and everything that they basically, they go out there and you're thinking these guys are supposed to be above this. No, back then it was a big deal.
Yeah.
As far as even if they're high up in the government.
Yeah.
And what's really funny is that one of them lost his son like 3 years previously, was 17 years old.
Wow.
Hamilton to the same thing, to a duel.
Wow. And, I didn't know that.
Yes. Yes. 3 years before, had a 17-year-old son, his oldest son, which was his favorite. Same thing, young, idiotic. And they thought that they were going to go out there, and he ended up getting shot. And he ended, you know, they took him to his parents' house and he died.
Wow.
And 3 years later, his father gets killed the same way. But a lot of these things, people don't realize back then, and people didn't forget. People had long memories back then.
Yeah, that's true.
So let me ask you, do you think that Jesse was involved, if not in keeping the gold, or what was it, transporting it? Or
I think he was, he was kind of like a treasurer in some cases, or at least for his area. He had a lot of gold. Everybody around him who he kept in his circle had a lot of wealth. In fact, they buried a lot more than they'd ever stole. But I think on the scheme of everything, they were an important part in their day, but they were just one small part in the whole picture. I mean, it involved people like, Jean Lafitte, for example, and others who weren't infamous, like Sir Francis Bacon, his mentor, John Dee. And when I traced it back, because, you know, I figured out the template. They used a template for the treasures, and it was in the form of a grid pattern. And that was the first one I figured out. And it's the grid pattern is kind of like it's three templates. There's a large, medium, and small. They all overlay and connect to each other. And when it went beyond that, I found that there's part of the template. It also includes a second template that's in the shape of the Kabbalistic Tree of Life. And that stretches from Williamsburg, Virginia, all the way to Victoria Peak, New Mexico. And like the treasure in New Mexico, Victoria Peak, New Mexico, was mentioned in the Watergate hearings. That's how big that treasure was. LBJ, Nixon knew about it. LBJ was said to have got his hands on some of it and used some of it to pay off third world countries purchasing elections. I don't know how true that is. That's just a rumor.
I wouldn't be surprised. Nowadays, it's like, I wouldn't surprise me at all.
Yeah, it wouldn't shock me. But that treasure, the grid pattern with the three different grid systems that all tie together, it all represents, it ties back into Kabbalah. It was the Kabbalistic Tree of Life, with the three veils of negative existence that coincide with the Tree of Life. And I thought, and I knew nothing about Kabbalah when I started this. It was before I joined. There was a lot of learning over the years, and it didn't happen overnight. It was over 25 years of research, but it tied. So I wanted to know why they did it in that shape. And then why the certain dimensions, like the middle pillar on the Tree of Life that goes from Williamsburg, Virginia to Victoria Peak, is 1,715 miles apart. And then and that's a long distance, especially back in those days. And then there's a lot that number 1,715 ties in different ways in that. But I wanted to know why they used the dimensions they did, the shapes and everything. So it was like doing a family tree only for an organization. And I already knew the involvement of the Masons. So I traced that back. It went back to some of the founding fathers, people like Benjamin Franklin and John Locke. beyond that and went to John Locke, Sir Francis Bacon. When I got to him, I thought, okay, this is a guy who did it all. He's credited with forming modern day Freemasonry. He's got to be the guy who came up with it all. And he wrote a book called The Newness, which is basically like a template for what America was supposed to be. But I was satisfied for about 3 days, and that nagging question kept bothering me. So I kept digging, and I found out his mentor was John Dee. And John Dee was like an occultist, and he was an alchemist, an occultist. He was a spy, a very skilled spy. He was the advisor to the queen. He was Sir Francis Bacon's mentor. And it kept going back through people, even Da Vinci. I mean, everybody knows that name. But I was looking, I was just trying to tie it in and see if it fit. And just connecting friends and mentors who had this, had ties with Freemasonry, Rosicrucianism, alchemy. And it led back to Jewish vice. And that shocked me. At first, it shocked me. And then I started noticing, you know, the Kabbalistic Tree of Life. That helped explain where Kabbalah entered the picture. But it was not just Jewish Kabbalah. It was also occult, Christian, and Jewish Kabbalah in a mix of those. Right. But it went through these rabbi, a long list of rabbis, back to a rabbi named Rashi. And Rashi was the favored court guest of Hugh, the Count of Champagne, who was one of the founders of the Templar. So I wrote my first book about the treasures, and I thought people are going to think I'm crazy when this comes out. But the thing that blew my mind, it was the biggest honor I could have had, was the current Grandmaster of the Knights Templar, Timothy Hogan, wrote a glowing endorsement for my book and told, and part of his endorsement, he said that I have cracked part of the code, a part of the code that deals with the treasures in from Jerusalem, from the temple in Jerusalem. And I thought, oh my God, this is awesome. But to wrap it up in a, like, make a long story short on that part, it's kind of, you've all heard like Holy Blood, Holy Grail, and the Da Vinci Code.
Of course.
I believe the treasure, a lot of treasures are still in Europe, but I think what I discovered on the treasures here in America and the people connected with it is the continuation of that story.
Let me ask you, do you think that originally the Templars were organized, as they say, because of the pilgrims and the Crusades, and then they became something else? Or were they put together always with that purpose?
I believe Timothy Hogan, actually, he's an author and a lecturer, Grandmaster for the Templar, stated that he believed that the Templar were formed. It was just a group of nine men. And, you know, when you hear that, think of nine men protecting all those pilgrims, that seems almost impossible. So, and what he stated said made a lot more sense to me. He said they knew that it was coming. You know, long before the war happened, people knew it was coming. So they were like emissaries in a sense. They went to people, different Islamic faith, people of Jewish faith. War was coming. They knew what happened during war, and they wanted, according to, part of their goal was to keep and protect items and information of sacred and historical value.
Right. Like exactly.
Some of the Jewish writings, Kabbalistic writings, treasures that they had that were more than just treasure. It was more of religious. And then there's a lot of things. I mean, items from the temple could include things like that. I don't know. But that sounds kind of interesting. It piques my interest. Right. That keeps me. Right. That's what keeps me up at night. So.
Well, you know what? And the reason why I asked that is you hear about the Templars, that they were basically the pilgrim, because people didn't realize back then, people, when they went as a pilgrimage, it would take years to go and come back. And of course, the Holy Land was the ultimate place to go to for pilgrimage, etc. And I'm thinking, how did these knights that were supposedly guarding, you know, along the pilgrim's route, how did they end up become bankers or money lenders? Because people don't realize back then, money lending or having to do with money, this was not really well thought of. It was like, that was like, for lack of a better word, like if you were up in the, you know, even the king or courtiers, you didn't do that. You borrowed, you know, or whatever.
Yeah.
But money lending and stuff like that, or banking, was not really a good occupation if you were well born. How's that?
That's right. That's exactly right. And that's why they, you know, on making the pilgrimage, like you said, that took years. When people wanted to do that, if they had been robbed on the way, they'd lose not only basically everything that they had and their family had. Sure. Destroy even their children wouldn't have their, you know, anything. Money all that broke. So the Templar turned into bankers over the years. And that's, you know, they would, when somebody was going to go on a pilgrimage, they would deposit their money. The Templar got the cut of it, and they gave them a note that was, you know, it was worth its weight in gold.
Right. Let me ask you, do you have any information? Do you see any tie with the Cathars, which, you know, of course, was persecuted as well by the Vatican?
I've touched on that a little. Yeah, the Cathars. There's also an interesting story on that involving some of their treasure. There was a Nazi by the name of, I think they called him Scar. And he was, from what I've read, he was part of the inspiration for Indiana Jones, only Spielberg, you know, rewrote it so that Indiana Jones was an American and he wasn't a Nazi. But they said that this guy named Scar, Himmler, sent Scar in, gave him, they sent him in a group of his own men that he picked who he knew could do the job. And they found where the Cathars, they started where the Cathars, and with a military mindset, instead of all the archaeologists who had tried to look for it, but failed, he looked at it from a different outlook or different perspective. And they claim that he found some of a large part of the Cathar treasures, like the Emerald Goblet and stuff like that. I can't remember all the details on the treasures, but the Cathar involvement, I think some of their spiritually minded, are their priests. I'm not sure what the term for their leaders were, but I think a lot of that melded into like Rosicrucianism, or at least lended some of their beliefs to that.
Right, because they believed in reincarnation. It was really funny because for most parts they were Christianized, but when they split off and they started believing in reincarnation, things like that, that's when the Vatican's like, what? And of course, you know, if you become powerful enough as far as your following, the Vatican always saw it as a threat to their power. You know, you're pulling away our potential followers, because that's basically sometimes what it boils down to.
Yeah, that's why a lot of churches, I know just normal churches growing up, you'd hear of half the congregation leaves and start their own church. It's usually because of power or money or some kind of that started from power.
If it was just a couple of kooks running around in the mountains, the Vatican wouldn't have bothered. It's like, all right, whatever.
That's right.
But once they gain in popularity, and you know what? But people don't realize, and you're absolutely right. A lot of these people, the way they lived, they were able to put away in like everything. You know, if you have personal property or riches, when you became a Cathar, you know, all these things came with you.
Yeah.
You know, if you were part of that belief system. So,
I would imagine there was a lot of wealth tied up with that.
Right.
You think that could have, maybe that was another reason the Catholic Church, maybe that's part of the reason why the Vatican attacked them.
I believe so. It's like everything. It comes down to, I mean, you know, you could say, well, you know, the ideology, it's, you know, like that when he's excommunicated this Scotland. Yeah. But, you know, that you could say, well, it's like you're a heretic. But I think deep down inside, for practical reasons, it usually boils down to money and or power kind
That's
of
true.
Deal.
Yeah.
You know, well, you know, for you know, like what happened with Martin Luther, with Protestantism, and, you know, what they call the schism. Look what happened with that. So,
that's true.
Yeah, they had, if anything, for all intents and purposes, the Vatican, even though it was religious, they knew human psychology pretty well as far as, you know, when they saw any movement that was going away from the teachings of the Vatican. Because back then, and even then, when you were talking about going to the Crusades, you know, you could buy indulgences, and you know, if you had led like a really kind of like bad, how can I say, or immoral life, but you were coming close to your time, You could basically buy prayers and indulgences to make sure that the gates, the pearly gates, open for you.
Buy a ticket.
Buy a ticket. People would, they if you had wealth, you could have, you could pay people to pray for you. And that's why you even had some of the nobility that they would say, you know, I will give the money, or I will build this church, or I will build this, or I will do whatever. But in exchange, you must have X amount of either priests or nuns, or be praying for my soul before, during, and after. Because that's the thing. People don't realize that people did believe in that. When I said that thing about the Scotland being excommunicated, this was a big deal. People really thought you were going to go to hell. Because all of a sudden, of course, your past caught up with you. You know, you remember all the horrible things you did, like, oh boy, you know. So that kind of, that people think that that's like and that was, that's and I even tell you, back then, I'm sure you've heard of it, you know, that's why you wouldn't have, that they wouldn't allow suicides to be buried in a consecrated churchyard. Same thing with murderers, you know, they would bury them at the crossroads, because it was like you were contaminating the cemetery or the consecrated ground if you allowed people like that to be buried. And that's how seriously people took their dogma, how the religious dogma. Yeah, it was very serious for them.
Famous violinist Paganini, he was able to hit notes on the violin nobody else could. And it ended up, people found out later and more recently, he had some kind of disease that would hit his fingers could reach around and curl around. It was some kind of ligament disease. I can't remember the name of it, but he had a disease that allowed him to do that. He was real long and his fingers reach strings that a normal person couldn't. And because of that, people claimed that he sold his soul to the devil so that he could have those abilities. And they didn't let him. They denied his body to a Christian burial after he died.
I did not know that.
Yeah,
I thought that's not why. Know that. Right, that you're too good.
Yeah, he played too good, so it must have been of the devil. So.
Right, it could have been a god, you know, because like no. Yeah, and I'm sure you've heard of all those. What was it? There was everybody that's always like you know, you go to the crossroads and you make a deal with the devil for whatever it is. Whether it's the talent or something, yeah. You know, but they when it comes, you know, eventually, or you know, fame, but a short life kind of deal. That kind of, you know, it always catches up with you.
I've heard a lot of stories like that. Like, in some of the old blues legends, they would claim they would sing songs about the crossroads.
Yes,
get popularity. Yes. People were like, oh. He must be really good. So,
right, because people don't realize the idea of why they would erect gallows or even sometimes bury suicides at crossroads is because supposedly so that the spirit or the ghost of this person could not follow you home. That was the idea behind it, that it would have all these roads. And that's how also people really believe that, of course, if you died in sin, you were going to, what, you had to be a restless spirit after death. So plus also sometimes when they would leave people on the gallows, it was like, hey, it's like a psyop, we're gonna wig you out because you're gonna go into the town and you see this guy hanging, is like, look what we do to you know, if you break the law here. That's what ends up happening to you. It's like, that's always a let me ask you, so how long did Jesse James live? How old was he when he died?
97 Oh, and he died in 1940.
So, and I take it that's old age. That's death by old age.
Yeah. There was a weird, I don't know what happened to him. It was when his early 80s, they thought he died. They thought he died. He wasn't moving. Okay. He was laying. The doctor held a mirror of his nose, and there was no vapor on, you know, no mist on the mirror. And they were having so they were going to bury him the next day, and they even had the grave already dug. They had a wake for him, and his dog's little finger moving. And that's the only reason he wasn't buried alive. 3 days later, he came out of what it was, and he was fine for a little more than a decade. So,
oh, he lived another 10 years? Oh, my God.
Yeah, well, yeah, he lived. Oh, yeah, it was about, I think it was probably, he died at 97, probably 13 or 14 more years. It was kind of cool and weird.
That's,
and I thought that's why. Yeah, well, that's why I used to put a bail on in like when they would bury people. I've heard stories like they would put a string through a casket and tie it to a little bell outside so that if somebody woke up, they could ring the bell.
Yes, right. Great. And you know what? And I hate to say it, if you want to clear a wake really fast, do one of those things of, the corpse starts moving. It's like,
yeah,
it's like you want to clear the room, and then you'll have some brave soul that's going to come back and look to see. But that, you
God,
know,
that would
sometimes you, and also the problem back then was that they also had, besides the fear with good reason of being buried alive, was also around that time. Also depends. I think this happened in other areas where they basically what they call, well, in England they call them resurrection men, but grave robbers, where there was a demand for bodies, fresh bodies, for anatomy classes in the universities, and they would be taking out fresh cadavers and put them on a train and ship them out. And can you imagine, you're alive and all of a sudden what ends up killing you is that, because sometimes what they would do is they would even use a hook and put like a hook to pull the person out, like under the chin.
Oh, yeah.
To pull them out. And because they had to get in and out of there quick. But that was quite common. And back then also, you know how people were buried also with jewelry and, keepsakes and things like that. This was another inducement for the grave robbers. It was like, we're going to get money for the body. Plus, if we find anything in the grave, if there's a ring or and chains and jewelry, people were buried with that stuff.
Gold teeth.
Once upon a time, that was recently. I was reading this story. This happened like right before the turn of the century, and this was in New York. Where Sing Sing prison is at. Yeah. And there's this lady who, she arrives on the train, okay? She's very well-dressed, and it describes her, but all her teeth are gold. This is one of the signs that you were, that if you had money that you could put gold teeth, you were. Bottom line, they found her body a couple of days, like, afterwards by the railroad tracks, and to make a long story short, they never were able to identify her. Nobody could understand how obviously this lady, who was she was well dressed, expensive dressing, had gold teeth. They could tell by the way her hands were kept and everything.
Yeah.
And how nobody could know. They sketched her since they had found her. And there was she hit by a train? Like, it didn't make what was it? One of her arms was ripped off and her head had come off. Okay, so there was controversy. Was she hit by the train, or did somebody kill her and put the body on the railroad track? You can't tell if there was any type of like wound. And make a long story short, she was never identified. Nobody, but they did sketch her anyway. They were trying to find her. And they had a bunch of people were saying, runaway wives, people that would fit that description. And then, a couple of days later, they would come up like, no, so-and-so, she's alive and well, she's in this, And the same thing with the gold teeth. That's why when you said that, people don't realize that was a sign of wealth, was when you could have gold pull on your teeth.
That's true.
And So what happened? He gets buried. What is it? Was there like a family cemetery where he got buried at, or what happened with that?
Yeah, he was buried at the local cemetery in Blevins, Texas. It's the Blevins Cemetery. Now it's not even a town. It's just the remnants of one old building right next to the cemetery, and that's all that's left. It's just a farming community.
Okay.
But he was buried there. Half it, when he did die, half his kids stayed. They didn't go to the funeral. Half of them stayed at home and dug up the yard looking for the treasure. And I thought that was kind of sorry, but, and that ended up leading to parts of the family splitting off and, you know, family fights and things like
that'll
that.
That'll do it. That'll do it right yeah, there. Yeah.
Real quick. Yeah. So yeah, they dug up, he had, he was married to at the time. It was his third wife. The first okay. wife died. She had cancer in the early 1900s and passed away. Then he married a young woman. The young woman he married, it didn't last, I think, even a year. He sent her back to her family, and and he took care of them financially for the rest of their life. That was kind of. Okay. But then the wife, I think he was in his 60s, late 60s, and she was in her 30s, and they hit it off perfect. He left a lot of gold with her. I think there was, they called them lard buckets. There was 13 lard buckets, and he put gold and silver coins in it and then covered it with lard, a hog's lard.
Okay.
So she got that in the will, and the kids didn't care about hog lard. They were looking for gold. She took off with her hog lard buckets full of gold and silver. And a couple of years later, it was funny. I was reading letters that had passed down through the family. They were writing letters to state and federal officials trying to demand that they order her to bring those lard buckets back. It was too late by then.
Okay. Because, and that's another thing, you know, of everybody that would know the dangers of putting money or anything in a bank, it would be Jesse James.
Yeah.
You know, as to like, why would you bury stuff or keep it there? It's because number one, you know, let's face it.
That's all
true. You need is, you know, plus if people don't know what you got.
Yeah. And then also right after the Great Depression, it ended. And people in general didn't trust banks at the time either.
Yes.
So I remember Sears Roebuck used to what they called fence safes. You could put a little safe on the bottom of a fence post and put it next to your house or anywhere you wanted and keep your money there. And nobody knew except the person who bought it. So.
Yes, people don't realize that. And every once in a while, you'll come across people that do renovations on older houses and they find stuff buried.
Yeah.
And it's because once upon a time, this was the safest bet, especially if you had, you know, because, you know, we all get caught up with paper money. But really, historically, it's always been gold or silver along those lines, especially gold. That's really the way you traded. And especially, after the Civil War, like you said, after the Depression, everybody's heard of Bonnie and Clyde.
Yeah. Oh, that's another thing that was interesting. Where Jesse lived in Blevins, Texas, there was a farm next door to his farm. It was several hundred acres, but the guy who lived there, his last name was Krause, K-R-A-U-S-E. He was Bonnie's maternal grandfather. And ooh, Bonnie and really? Clyde. So Bonnie and granddad moved right more to Jesse. And I haven't found any connection I haven't found anything to point that they were in cahoots, that Bonnie and Clyde were part of the group. It's kind of interesting.
Right. You know, what was it? They say how many degrees of separation there is from one thing to the other. And sometimes, like you said, they're close, but there is not real connection. It's just proximity because of coincidental, but still at the same time. So then what happened? Sure. So the family, what happened to his wife? Obviously now she had did she stay living on the property, or who was the one that ended up staying there?
She left. She left and married another man and started her own family with him. But really? She was a good girl to Jesse, and I think he wanted her to have that. Most of the rest gold he buried, like most of the gold he had, that belonged to, like the stuff he was burying, that belonged to Freemasonry, I believe. The rest of it, like the stuff that she had 13 buckets with a lot of gold and silver. So she was set for life. But some of it, he kept his own. He kept a cut of it, of things, but I don't know how much he kept. He had a lot of gold buried. His family found some of it. buried around the property. There was a large, there, he got mad at a lot of them because he bought all his kids' crops.
Okay.
And there were, he had seven kids. Most of them were kind of spoiled. And they would blow through their money and then they'd come back begging for more. And he finally got fed up with it. And he took all his, the legend in the family was he took one of the treasures gone to them and he buried it where they'd never find it. And that, that was sense. It. People were looking for it. People spent years looking for it and they never did find it. So.
And you know what? People, you know, everybody thinks that, you know, modern day that you're, you know, have, you know, you've heard about the kids living in the basement till they're 30. Okay. But even back then you would have that version of, hey, we're going back to dad to save the bacon when it comes to, and let me ask you, were all his kids from his first marriage or did he have any children with any of the other wives?
All the known kids were from his first marriage. The other wives he had no children with, but it's rumor that he had a couple of kids before he was married. One or two kids up in different states. So,
right. That's possible. That's very possible. You know, back then there was no DNA, so, but still, it was one of those things where that is so, so at this point, you know, and I want to say, for lack of a better word, having that money is great, but I think there comes a time, whether he was like, for lack of a transporter, and when he took his cut, you know, I think that after a while, you realize having too much of that is more cursed than a gift because.
Yeah.
You know, either that's you have to be taking care of it or you, you know, if it gets out, you have it. It's like who wants, whoever's around you is like, what do they really want? They just.
Exactly. Suddenly they become a target instead of a friend. So.
Exactly. And even family members, like you were saying, all of a sudden it's like, yeah, you're being nice to me because you want something from me, not because you really love me or anything like that.
Right. Well, that's like a lot of people, you hear those stories of people who win the lotto. It ruins their marriage, ruins their friendships. They end up broke later on because they didn't know how to spend it. But I remember my late uncle always said if he won the lotto, he wouldn't give anybody money. Because if you give somebody money, he said they're going to cuss you thinking you're better than they are. If you don't give them money, they'll cuss you because you're cheap. So he said either way, you get cussed.
Right. Yeah. It's like you keep it, you just keep it a secret, you know, and that's it. And it's like, I'm living on my retirement or whatever. Sometimes it's like that's human nature.
And then everybody in your family and all your friends affording all those vacations. So,
there's a lot of people, believe it or not, a lot of famous and not so famous murders have been committed because the belief that that person or persons had of money, physical money in their house.
I believe it.
And I'm sure you've heard back in the 1960s where Truman Capote wrote that book In Cold Blood, which became really famous. And he researched it with the two murderers before they were executed. And basically that family, which was a farming family out in Iowa, they were targeted because they ran a dairy and a farm. And one of these inmates had heard from another inmate in jail that that man had a safe where he kept gold. I mean, not gold, money, physical money that he would pay.
Wow.
By the way, later on, it turned out that was not the man would write checks. You know, this thing of him having the stash of money in his safe didn't turn out to be accurate at all. But based on this hearsay, when they were in jail, they show up there to this little Iowa farm, and they end up killing the parents and the two teenage kids.
Wow!
This is how that whole story of In Cold Blood comes out. You know, it takes a while. I want to say that Truman Capote did a really good job in that sense of, you know, where they did like a real life drama. And again, that belief in that if you could get a hold of money. You know, like whether it's paper money or anything, that if people know you have it, that's why you bury stuff like that.
That's true.
And don't let anybody know.
Keep it a secret.
Keep it a secret. Because, unfortunately, there's always people like that. That even now, you know, with even though, you know, everything now a lot of times is digital, still, you know, there's There's always the person. Let's face it, nobody can trace cash or gold or silver. That's true. So that's at this true. Point, where do you think that, because everybody's heard of, you know, the show of Curse of Oak Island, and that supposedly the Templars had, that was one of their stuff, you know, where they ended up at to get rid of or bury. Do you think there was anything or is anything at Oak Island or ever was anything at Oak Island?
I think there was, and I don't know about now. After all they've done, there could be, but I have a feeling Oak Island was a staging point where they stopped. But then they may have recovered it later and then moved on. But the fact that it was part of that theory, if they did recover it, it sure seems like they went through a lot of trouble to make it look something was there, you know, because it was still, it didn't look like, the flood tunnels, the coated rocks kind of stuff, the different layers of, what was it, fiber and different types of soil. Maybe there's still something there. I'm not sure. Or maybe it was a decoy. If it was a decoy, it was an extremely elaborate decoy. I don't think it was a decoy.
When you look at that, it's like, okay, you know, if you ever need to get your treasure for whatever reason, you might as you know, I can't see why you would make it so difficult on yourself or somebody that you send to take it if you needed to move it. You know, you're going to make it so dangerous that you cannot access it because you have to go through all these, like you said, like an Indiana Jones type of goblet.
I wonder if there was a back door. Could there have been a back way?
Now that makes sense. That there's a way to get to it. Like, go down that tunnel. It's right there.
But it's, I don't know. I personally, there may be something there still. I don't know, but it's part of that grid, that treasure grid that I'd mentioned earlier that I discovered. It's not part of the Tree of Life, but it's part of the grid that covers the Americas, and it also lines with the Newport Tower that they, some claim that John built it, others claim the Templar built it. In a way, they were part of the same organization. So either way. Right, but it lines up with a lot of weird areas of historical significance and also other features. But like New Mexico, the Los Lunas Decalogue, it's a boulder with a lot of Hebrew language. You know, I don't know what it says exactly, but that. Pioneers, when they showed up, they asked the Native Americans who did that. And the Native Americans said it was there when they got there. So that's a mystery unto itself. And the template lines up with, I don't know if there's a treasure there or if it's just an area of, maybe it's a treasure marker. I don't know. There's others that believe that's part of a trail that leads to the Ark of the Covenant. I don't know if that's true. It wouldn't. I keep open-minded about a lot of that. Anybody's guess is as good as mine as to what it's. But knowing that it's on the template, I think it has something to do with treasure.
And I'm sure you've heard, of course, that the Superstition Mountains also has, its's own treasure, hidden treasure. And I've heard that there's people out there that also have gotten lost and because they really don't understand.
They call it the Lost Dutchman's Mine.
Right. Yep. And I think that unfortunately, it's romanticized and people don't understand what they're going to encounter as far as the terrain.
It's very dangerous.
It is. And unfortunately, there's been people that they've never been, you know, have disappeared or they've died and they found them later. And so, it's that thing with the treasure. I can see where the allure is, but I think a lot of people, it's like they start seeing in their head the Indiana Jones kind of version of treasure hunting.
Yeah, well, that's, and what you just said ties in with, like there was some, those spots I'd mentioned where treasure used to be in the Texas Rainover Recovery. It didn't look like any place you would, you know, when you're romanticizing treasure, I always think it's a hill covered with boulders and there's a cave, things like that. This was out in the open field. And that's what always blew my mind when I first was shown those. It was out in an open field. Nothing special about it. It was just a field. And somebody buried treasure there a long time ago.
That's the thing that, you know, you hear that, oh, because you have to go up the hill and then down the mountain and then in the gully and underneath the cave. And then,
yeah.
And I'm thinking to myself, you know what? I get it. I get it. You don't want somebody just to be able to stumble over this. But if at some point you're going to be coming back for this thing, okay, the last thing you want to put yourself through is to go through that just to get the money. You know, it's like, some part of me says that. Or like you said, it's just a decoy. You know, let's draw up this very convoluted map, which will just take them nowhere. Right.
There was one treasure buried in Oklahoma. A guy found it about 20 years ago. It was right off of the Chisholm Trail, and he followed codes carved in trees and on rocks. And he found the treasure, and it was just under a boulder. All he had to do was flip the heavy stone over, and there's the treasure. It wasn't even buried. It was just under a boulder.
You know what?
And it was over a million in treasure.
Right. You know, and that's the thing. You know, everybody thinks of, you know, when Indiana Jones, and he lifts it up, and then the boulder chases you, and it's the arrows, and it's like, sometimes that's not exactly it. Because
that's right.
Just for the sake of that, it's not practical. Especially because this is the thing. Most people don't realize that whoever put that gold there, they wasn't planning to leave it there forever.
Yeah. You
know, sometimes things happen. They want to come back and get it. And as a matter of fact, this is an article I read like about a couple of weeks. It happened in November. In Spain, they were digging, same thing for a road or some construction. And they pull up and they found these, what they call ampules, which are like those vases, but they're sealed. Okay.
Yeah.
There was 19 of them. When the machinery cracked some of them, and they found they were full of Roman coins. All right.
Oh wow.
Some of them, the ones that were sealed, they basically found them like 6 years ago, and recently they put out what it is that they found, They kind of figured out that there was like 2,800 coins in each of the ampules. And later on, they figured out that this had been, they say that somewhere in that area, there had to have been like a Roman villa. And this was under like the portico of, they said that they usually had buildings like where they kept animals and the people that worked there. And somebody had buried it under there, like right where you walk in. All right. And this was like in the 4th century. AD.
Wow.
Of course, you know, this is when Rome did, and it showed all the, you know, all the different, because back then, you know, the coins were minted with the face of the emperor. And they were even saying that the majority of them were from the Emperor Diocletian because his coins had more silver in it. All right. So they had like a total of 58,000 coins. I don't know how much the actual find is of itself, but then you think somebody took the trouble of burying 19 of these, they're like vases that were about this big, like maybe a foot or a little bit over, and sealed them, filled them up with coins from different things, buried it under, let's say, under the entrance to like a warehouse, because they said that it was like a building that was like a granary, buries it there. And then they said that eventually, like 200 years later, everything was demolished. And now it was found like, what, 2 centuries later almost? And then you think, okay, nobody's going to forget that they put away 19 vases full of coins.
Yeah.
This was somebody, I imagine, that met an unexpected death. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And they were discussing that why would somebody do that? You know, putting the coins away. And they said that back then, around the time that the Roman Empire was starting to teeter-totter, and that there was inflation. So they said that if you were going to do any big money deal, like a purchase of land or anything like that, you could only do it with coin, a lot of coin. So this is why somebody would keep this amount of coins there. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, this is not something you forget about and walk away from. This is somebody that died unexpectedly. All right. And there it goes. And two centuries go by.
Wow.
So yeah, the thing of burying stuff has been around for a while, but yeah, being too difficult to find, to me most people they're planning to come back for that stuff.
Yeah.
At some point in time. Yeah. At some point in time. Well,
that was the other thing. Like Oak Island, for example, that's real difficult. And then there was one, Manley Palmer Hall. He was another 33rd degree Mason. He wrote the Christians of All Ages. His wife was Marie Bauer Hall. And she, before she had married Manley Palmer Hall, she had been researching, and then later she married him. They both researched, but they found encrypted writings in the works of Shakespeare. She believed Sir Francis Bacon was Shakespeare or wrote most of it. Anyway, they found encrypted writings.
I've heard also that it was the Earl of Oxford. I've heard other theories about that. Shakespeare wasn't really Shakespeare, but anyway, keep going.
I've heard. So she had writings, and it led her to Williamsburg, Virginia. There's a church there called Bruton Parish Church, and the Bruton Parish Church, the one that's there now was built in 1715, but there was one before that, and she said when she decrypted all the encrypted writings and symbols, it led her to the original foundations of the original church, and people mocked her. They didn't believe her, but they gave her permission.
She went there, where did it lead her to? What did she see there?
It was the original foundations of the first church that was built there at Bruton Parish Church. And it was just a few feet away from the church there now. People mocked her, and she proved them wrong. And she went further. There were also anagrams on the tombstones of the cemetery that pointed to it also. So she found original foundations. She proved her detractors wrong. She went further and said that there's a vault 20 feet beneath where the altar was in the church that contains, it was treasure and information that would rock the foundations of history and religion. And I thought that's interesting. She found original foundations, which all the experts believed were non-existent, and she proved them wrong. So she started to dig for that vault, and they put her in jail. They told her to leave. She didn't want to leave, so they put her in jail, and she didn't go back after that. And it was interesting to me because also the said that the Rockefeller family purchased most of the old part of that town. They don't own the church, but said that they control the board of directors. And I thought, well, we never know what's there. But I thought that was an interesting. That was part of the Tree of Life template, and that would have been the top part of it. I'd love to know what was in the vault and where the vault is. They said they did a ground penetrating radar and identified that there was a vault or a void beneath that, but nobody would allow them to dig.
Well, did you hear this? This was. I don't know if you heard about this. And this was maybe maybe a year ago or a little bit over a year ago, that there was this group that I want to say around Washington or Virginia, that they supposedly came across some what they called Confederate gold. All right.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And basically, because that's another theory that I've heard, that in some cases where supposedly there might be something buried of value, the government has either made it a park, some type of park where basically nobody can own it. You know, it belongs to the government. Yeah. But in that one, basically the FBI booted the group that found it, like, get out of here. And then they were told, we didn't find anything in there. Something like that.
And I read all about that. And I know one of the guys that was involved in it. We're not friends, but we're acquaintances. He spoke to my late mother a couple of times, and then he's never emailed me. I just know of him because he used to try to talk to my mom. They they said they found the treasure. The FBI swept in, kicked them out. And people said that they heard heavy equipment, but the FBI said they didn't do anything, didn't get anything, and they were just real closed mouth about it.
It was like they did that, but I think they even put up tents. Like the FBI did one of these 24/7 kind of like removals.
Yep. It's the way the article was written. It sounds like the FBI probably got it.
Well, the thing was, and this is the thing that supposedly the motivation behind the FBI was that this gold was supposedly stolen during the Civil War. Okay, so technically it would belong to the government. Yeah. How's that? But see, at the same time, it's like, okay, we have to take your word for this. How's that work?
And what's the statute of limitations on a robbery?
Exactly.
And that was an act of war, so I don't know.
It was supposed to be en route, I think, to the Mint, something like that. And it got stolen and then buried and then... what's the name of the group? I think it's Finders Keepers or something like that. That they do that. This is what they do. And I was like, man, that's incredible. And see, that's another thing I've heard, that a lot of places that especially in the middle of nowhere, they've made them, the government has taken them over, made them into national parks and stuff like that, where you can't just go in there and start digging. You can't. You just can't.
That's true. That's very true. And you're right. A lot of the treasures that I know of were on areas like that. Some of the ones here in Texas that we were shown, not three of those were on private property, but it was, I don't know who, I don't know if somebody watched it. I have a feeling they kept an eye on it, but one of the big ones, like the 700 bars of gold that I had mentioned earlier, that spot is located on Fort Hood Military Reservation outside of Killeen, Texas.
Yeah. Yes. So. Yeah. There's certain things, and you know, a lot of people don't realize that nowadays, if you come across anything that, how can I say it, was stolen or like, in other words, that you didn't purchase it, or that the original, that it wasn't acquired through, you have to end up giving it back.
Yeah.
People get all caught up. Like, I'm gonna, less than a year ago, I don't know if you heard of, I think the lady, it was in Texas. This lady found, what she thought was the bust or the head of, fake, obviously, of a Roman, was a senator or an emperor, something like that.
Okay.
She buys it for like $29 at the Goodwill, thinking, wow, it's just a statue. It's just a really nice. She comes to find out it's originally from like the first century.
Wow. Right?
And then they start, of course, a piece like that is like basically a museum piece. They were, they described how it ended up because of the person that owned it, I think, passed away, and then it ended up in the Goodwill kind of thing. Make a long story short, they said that because that piece originally, and I cannot remember, had been taken or stolen without permission, she had to end up returning it to the museum or the collection that originally had it, like years, like 80 years ago or something like that, 100 years ago. It was a long time ago. And
Oh, I'd be mad. I would be.
And hopefully, and of course, they said they didn't disclose, and they were saying, well, what they did was they made basically a clone of it so she could have it there, like the fake one. And they were saying, and maybe, they weren't obligated, but that the museum could give her some type of like a little reward, which of course is not anything worth. And that's what I'm saying. You know what? And I'm going to end the show with this. When I hear about these stories, don't get me wrong, I understand that if something was taken, but that end person didn't take it, makes you think how many pieces of whatever art, sculptures, treasures are in private hands, will never see the light of day because when they're bought and sold, it's done very privately.
That's true.
Okay. Because
that's why
they're going to say either the country of origin, if it was taken, let's say from a foreign land, they're going to step in and say, hey, that belongs to us, send that back to us. Or if it was a museum or whatever, whoever was the original and could say, hey, We don't care. That belongs to us. And guess what? They make you send it back. So I think that there's a bunch of stuff out there in private collections that private transactions are done.
That's true. You know,
from buyer to seller. And because everybody understands that if you ever say anything about this, guess what? It's done. You're going to have, it's gone. And you're going to, and not going to get a penny for it.
Well, that's so, like you know, the guys who find sunken Spanish ships, the government of Spain takes them to court and they usually win. Well, what bothers me, because they said that was originally ours. And I thought, well, wait a minute. That belonged to the natives in Central America that the Spaniards killed and took the gold from them. So it should go back to Mexico, but it doesn't. It goes to
Spain. But you know what? The thing about this is, and you would think, what's the statute of limitations on this? You know, as a matter of fact, you could even say, you know what? It was an act of God. If a hurricane came along and sunk your boat, that ship, that galleon, you know, as far
that
as...
Yeah, exactly. That was an act of God, and it didn't belong to anybody after that.
Yeah. But people don't realize that when you hear about these people finding these treasures, they get a very small percentage or share of what that find is. It's not like it's all mine.
Yeah.
I don't know. You remember that old money, that old movie, The Deep, that came out, I think it was in the 70s or 80s when they were diving in the Bahamas. Oh, no, in Bermuda. I'm sorry. And they find that galleon.
Oh, I think I remember that one. I've seen a lot of treasure movies.
This was with Nick Nolte. This was when everybody was really young. I want to say it was in the late 70s. And it was written by the same guy, Peter Benchley, that wrote Jaws.
Okay.
And basically it's a couple and they're tourists in Bermuda and they're diving and they come across a Spanish galleon and they find one of the pieces, but then it gets complicated because they find another boat with heroin ampules on top of it. It's a great movie, by the way. But
I do remember seeing that. Yeah. Right.
And but you know, you look at that and it looks really exciting, but people don't realize that treasure hunting can get complicated
real quick
with governments, like whether the origin or in whose waters you're basically finding it in, things of that nature. It's mine, I found it, it's all mine.
It's whoever has the most power behind them, that's usually who ends up with it.
And there's a on the last note, when you said that thing about Steven Spielberg, Steven Spielberg, one of his early movies was that movie, The Goonies, which was, and in it, it had a pirate ship. Okay. Yeah. And apparently his inspiration was off the coast of California. There was a rumor of a Spanish galleon that had wrecked in the Pacific coast.
Yeah.
All right. And they kept getting blocks of beeswax and other timbers that would wash on shore. Nobody could ever figure it out. And this supposedly is how he got the inspiration for that part of the Goonies. And it turns out that yes, because apparently this ship, they still can't figure out the ship was going from Mexico to the Philippines. That's why it was on the Pacific side. And they can't understand how it got so far. Of course, that was off the coast of Oregon. But they think that got caught in a bad storm and it sunk, but they would carry, they finally found pieces of the beeswax. They traced the timbers to stuff, something that was cut in the Philippines. Plus they found actual the beeswax, like bees in it, you know, because they have been finding chunks.
Wow.
But yeah, that was the inspiration for the Goonies as far as the pirate ship that they find in the cave. So yeah, people
That's
get inspired,
cool.
inspired by anything. Yeah. But yeah, those Spanish That's galleons, cool. there's a bunch of them that sunk. So yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, if you have the deep pockets, but I doubt anybody that you could just like be able to find this, find the gold, keep it for yourself and not tell anybody. It's like, it's a complicated.
That would be hard. That would be hard because the first thing most people would do is go out and buy a car or a house, and then that gets red flagged, and then they end up people are looking at them. Yeah.
Yeah.
So anything you do. Yeah.
Yeah. You know that it that it's like, but and I'm sure there's people go, you know, I'd rather deal with a headache. Don't worry, I'll figure it out. I'll get a good attorney. Just figure it out. Thanks.
Yeah. That's true.
It has been absolutely wonderful to talk to you. Let me ask you, are you working on any book or anything now as we speak? Or planning
right now, I finished my third one, and it hit the shelves over the summer in July. And right now I'm taking, I work as the director of tourism and economic development in Marshall, Texas. So I've been real busy lately, but I've got a couple of books I want to work on. I just need to find the time.
What's the title of the book that you just released?
Oh, it was The Secret History of the Wild Wild West. I've got a picture of it right here.
Oh, look at that. You know what? I'm sure that when you did that research, you found what? Did you get a lot of surprises when you were doing your research?
Yeah, I did. It seems like anything involving Jesse and a lot of the connections he had always ends up shocking me. Well, like the Jean Lafitte thing, the connection with Jean Lafitte, his connection with Johnny Ringo and a lot of other people, Billy the Kid and others, Freemasonry. Right. It's always something. And it's like those guys lived amazing lives. Mm-hmm. And when the truth comes out about them, it's almost so wild, it's hard to believe. But
right. And you know what's really funny? That a lot of these guys like Bat Masterson, all these people, they all knew each other.
Yeah.
It was a
small world.
Yes. Yeah. They knew of each other. They even sometimes states, different states, but they'd circulate and they all knew each other somehow
it is
or
wild.
Other.
Yeah. Yes. And I mean, for some reason, and it's hard when you growing up watching old West movies and stuff like that, it seems like, you know, you had one guy here and he never met these other people. But you find out the truth is they all met. They knew a lot. They all knew each other. Not all of them, but most of them knew one another or knew of them. And the places they rode, like on horseback, riding from Kentucky to Texas, doing robberies in different places in Virginia and then back to Nebraska, Ohio. It was weird.
When I really got, I wrote back in 2017, a book, it was called The Haunted History of the Old West Wicked Ladies and the Bad Hombres They Loved. Yeah. So it was mostly about the frontiers town. And that's how you hear about, I researched and I found these guys. One day you're wanted by the law and then the next day you're the sheriff.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. It was a weird life.
Then that friend of yours, you'd send him, hey, you know, my brother's gotten himself in trouble in that town. He's got a warrant out of so-and-so, go get them for me. And they would. They would do that stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's just crazy. And Belle Starr, she's another person. I think there needs to be more written on her. She was a lot more than just an outlaw woman. She was like a major figure in an underground world. She had friends that were judges and other politicians, friends who were outlaws, bank robbers. She had an amazing life. And then she got killed. She was riding her horse back to her house, and some coward shot her from the bushes, shot her in the back with a shotgun.
Well, you know that one of the ones that they believe it is, he ended up here in Florida, down on the West Coast.
Yeah, I've heard that. Yeah, heard about that.
And back then, this was around the turn of the century, he ended up doing like one of those sugar plantations. But there's something, an area on the west coast of Florida called 10,000 Islands. And back then, it was so mosquito infested that the law, if you went there, the law wouldn't go after you. You'd be like, hey, man, forget it. we're not going in there and get you. So he moved back there. And he ended up killing a few more people, by the way, until they finally, the little town, shot him dead. They got so sick and tired of him. Because what they would do is that he would bring, what happened is he would bring a lot of these, not ex-cons, but people that were on the run from the law. He would use them as labor on his plantation, his little sugar plantation on these islands.
Wow.
And then when it came time to pay them, guess what?
Oh,
he did away with them. He killed them. And of course, you know, if you're out in the middle of nowhere and you're running from the law, you have no family. Nobody's going to be around to say, hey, what happened to so-and-so?
That's true.
And he was even known to kill women. And I believe that one of the things that they were saying that they suspected him in the murder of Belle Starr was that even though he was a really tall man, he had very small feet for a man. Okay. and that this correspondence and some tracks that they had found behind the bushes or somewhere where somebody was hiding that said that the shot at Bell Star. And he was in that group. He traveled with them in that group of people that she was at.
Okay.
And you know, when there's a point in time that it's like, you know, I need to get out of Dodge, wherever Dodge happens to be. And that's when he came down, like right before the turn of the century, down into the west coast of Florida. And he started doing his thing there. And like I said, finally, the townspeople gunned them down. they gunned them down because they were just like, and at that time, like I said, the sheriff or the law was like a three-day ride away.
Wow.
So they took it upon themselves. And that was the, what was his name? Bloody Ed Watson. That's his name. Well, they call him Bloody Ed Watson, but yeah. So there we go. Okay.
That's a cool story.
Yeah, it is. And it's like, again, you know, without physical proofs, but I remember there was a lot of things that it looked like he might have been the person that killed Bell Star.
That's bad. I'm glad they killed him. So,
well, no, you know, when people say people took the law into their own hands, they did because sometimes they had no choice. And also that thing about, you know, when I did that, you know, a lot of these, they were higher end brothels or you had a lot of movers and shakers in the government that would come to these brothels, like judges and sheriffs. And they would sometimes, they say that in some cases they would do a raid and they'd have the sheriff and one of the judges like dropping down out of a second floor window, you know, because like, you didn't tell me about the raid, you know, they would say how these brothels would remain open, the high-end ones.
Yeah.
It was because usually their clientele were
powerful people,
exactly. Yeah, that happened quite a lot. Dan, it has been absolutely great to speak to you. I there was so much we could talk about. And I'm hoping you'll come back another time so we could keep on talking about the stuff. But it's been great.
Well, thanks. I had a great time. It's been an honor being on your show. And anytime you want me to come back.
Well, before I forget, for my podcast listeners, what's a website that they can go to? I'm going to put a link to the website, but for the podcast listeners,
it's author. I'm sorry. I always forget the website address. I don't know why. It's Daniel Duke Author. I think it's Daniel Duke Author.
Yes. No, I'll tell you right now because authordanduke.com.
Yeah. And it's not author Dan. It's author Daniel. I messed up when I wrote Dan.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Okay. I'm glad you, because that's.
Because I have my Facebook is author Dan Duke because somebody took Daniel. And it, but my website is author Daniel Duke.
Daniel Duke. Okay.
Thank you.
Right. Because like I said, no, I usually write it down because in the credits of the show, I put that link there. But, you know, I also have a podcast version of the show. And that's why I asked my guests to put out what their website is. So it's authordanielduke.com.
Yep. And you can find my books anywhere. They're innertraditions.com innertraditions is my publisher. It's at Amazon, Barnes and Noble, anywhere they sell books pretty much.
Okay. Excellent. Excellent. Again, thank you so much. It has been absolutely wonderful to talk to you, and I wish you the best of luck in all your projects.
Thank you. Same to you, and I hope to hear from you again sometime.
Likewise. Take care, of course.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Okay. Wow. Yeah. You know what? I complain that sometimes the Old West and the frontier life is more romanticized, but I fall prey to the romanticism. I do. And, but what he talks about, like when I did the research for that book that I wrote, the Old West Wicked Ladies and the Bad Hombres They Loved. And I hate to say, because a lot of people, back then, a lot of women, because out of necessity, because there was really no on the frontier, and they ended up, being prostitutes. All right. There wasn't sometimes if their husbands died, unless you lived in like one of the bigger cities, like in the East, like New York, that maybe you could work in a shop or something like that. Your options as far as employment were not there. All right. And a lot of women, they were widows, you know, they went to work and they would work in the, you know, because a lot of people think sometimes of, you know, the prostitutes, I'm not talking streetwalkers. These would usually be like, there's different grades of brothels. There was even somewhere, the boarding house, it was, let's say a woman owned a boarding house, and she would rent out a couple of the rooms to girls that sometimes even worked in factories, but they weren't making any money. And they would basically turn into a quasi brothel in the weekends. And they would prostitute maybe on the weekends or on a Saturday or a Sunday. Others were lured. For example, I'm sure for those of you who remember that HBO series called Deadwood, there was a character there, which was very well played. I can't remember the actor's name. He was in, oh my God. Well, anyway, he played a guy named Swearingen, which, by the way, there was a Swearingen there. I can't remember his first name. And he owned a theater and he owned a bar, saloon. That basically, that's really how you made your money. And that's usually the setup in these frontier towns where you had the saloon or the dance hall downstairs, and then upstairs you had the brothels. Okay, this is where the girls took you. And usually you would see that more like in the mining towns or the frontier towns and things like that. So you had some girls that all they did was they would dance around with the cowboys or the guys, steer them to the bar, have them drink, you know, basically spend their money on drinks. They would get watered down drinks, but they would not prostitute themselves, because they made enough money that by being basically dancing around with these guys, because by the way, usually in these towns, men outnumbered women a lot. So these girls, these men would just to have a chance to dance with a girl, with a woman, they'd be like, great. So, and then there was others that, of course, they were prostitutes. So this guy Swearingen, what he would do is he would put out these handbills and he would lure like these farm girls, you know, whatever, come and, you know, I've got this honorable employment, whatever. He would make stuff up. When they would get to Deadwood, then he would bring the surprise on them. No, you know, you need to, this is what I've got. You're going to be the dance hall girl or, you know, be working upstairs. And these girls are like, huh? And he would say, oh yeah, by the way, because you need to pay me for bringing you out here. And by the way, most of the times these girls didn't have any money to go and go back to where they came from. So that's how he would basically bring them in and tie them into that type of work. They wouldn't go out there expecting that they were going to be prostituted, but that's how they would end up and be like, okay, you need to pay me off. You know, I spent X amount of money to get you out here, but that's not the work. I don't care. You owe me that money. And you're going to go back to work. And again, these are frontiers town. All they had was a lot of saloons, you know, and more saloons. Saloons usually outnumbered, I think, like any other establishment besides, you know, general supply store or something like that. So, yeah. But yeah, a lot of these towns, these stories about the Old West, they romanticized them. There was a lot of adventure, but there was a lot of hardship. As a matter of fact, I'm watching that show, which is 1883. It's a series and it's a prequel to that Yellowstone. And I've watched like maybe one episode, and it's kind of accurate as the hardships that people would encounter when they would go out into the frontier to go west, to go wherever they were going to go for land. Because remember, this is, you know, for a lot of immigrants, especially that came from Europe or anywhere else, if you own land, like the gentry, if you owned land, that meant everything. That was it. You know, you own that land. So if you broke your back farming the land, felling trees, you were doing it for yourself and for your family, whereas not for anybody else. So this is, of course, was the allure of going out west into dangerous areas where there were Indians, where the, you know, it could snow and basically you'd freeze to death, because if they were usually promised land. And of course, the government in many cases wanted settlers out there, let them go out there, do the hard work, establish a town, you know, get a bank going and churches. And, you know, eventually they knew that even if at the beginning the towns were really rough, like they had what they usually call tenderloins, which is where you had the bars and the saloons and the houses of ill repute. Eventually, if you got enough regular settlers, they would either chase away okay, go to that part of town. That's going to be like the rough part of town. And then they would basically establish a town with the churches and your stores and all your your regular stuff. And that's really what they wanted. They wanted people to go out there and settle it. And then, of course, on the outskirts, you would have the people that had their farms, their ranches, et cetera, et cetera. But yeah, that show that I've been watching, it's kind of brutal, but it's kind of accurate when you do the, you know, the research, like, you know, when the people would go on these covered wagons that they were heading out west to whatever west was. Because remember, the west, sometimes it could be as far west as Missouri, the Ohio Valley, all those things. Let me tell you something. You had to be really desperate and really brave because so many things could kill you. It wasn't only that anything, disease, if you didn't know what you were doing. Yeah, it's quite different, which, by the way, gives testimony to settlers wherever they came from, you know, whether they were Eastern in the United States or they had come in and immigrated through, let's say, the Ellis Island, which was, and then decided to keep going out because they wanted their piece of land. And let me tell you something, talk about hardy people. Whew. That speaks volumes. But anyway, guys, I hope you like the show. I really love speaking to Dan. I urge you to go to his website, which, let me repeat it, it's authordanielduke.com. And he's got 3 books out: Jesse James and the Lost Templar Treasure, The Mysterious Life and Fake Death of Jesse James, and Secret History of the Wild Wild West, which he said that was the last book that he just released this year. Okay, so again, come back. I've got a lot of interesting guests, great guests coming on. Like new ones like Dan, repeat from other times that they've written new books. They've got a lot of interesting stuff to share. And again, thank you so much for coming back every week and spending this time with me. And until next time, take care.